Welcome.
Simply the best college football has to offer, the NFL. I have done the math. I've looked at the tape. I've gone through the matrix. I have done the grading. Done the research. And I'm giving you my preseason rankings, position by position. And hey, college football's fast approaching. We're like 2 weeks off. So here's some guys you need to keep an eye out for. But remember, this is my opinion. So if you have your own opinions, go ahead and leave them in the comment section below and we could have a discussion. Be fun, hopefully. With that being said, what's crack-a-lackin'? It's your boy Broshmo, just in case you did not know so. Go ahead, give me a sub and give me that nice thumbs up. It's always much appreciated, much obliged. Hopefully you're enjoying the content and the channel, it's growing. Y'all are doing a great job. Good job, y'all. I got more stuff on the way in the future, but it does require growth. But like I said, y'all are killing it. Now, without further ado, let's talk about the most exciting position on offense, and that's the interior offensive line. At number one, I have Tyler Bedaz, who has been the best center in college football for the last 2 years, and that'll be three after this season. If you checked out any of my mock drafts, you know I love Jack Anderson out of Texas Tech, and he's the only other offensive interior lineman with a first round grade. Notre Dame's Tommy Kramer improved immensely in 2018 after moving around the offensive line and being benched in 2017. He's now cemented his position there at left guard. He's great in pass protection. Logan Sternberger is a prospect I've overlooked when making my rankings this past summer. He's a great run blocker, but he can stand to get better in pass pro. Reedson is a tested vet and has ideal size to play guard, but is easily knocked off his spot, kind of like a spinning top. Darrell Williams has great versatility, playing everywhere on that Mississippi State offensive line. Thayer Mumford plays tackle for Ohio State, but projects better at guard. I have Jack Hansen from Oregon at number 8. He's played all his snaps at center, but I think he will be a guard in the NFL. He has had penalty problems just this last season especially. Scouts are going to be watching Georgia's Fromm, Swift, and Thomas, but Solomon Kinley is really good in pass protection and might get a couple of looks from scouts. At 10, I have Hakeem Adeniji from Kansas, who plays tackle, but I think his frame's a little too slender to play on the outside, and he'll probably be moved inside. A couple of guys to watch out for is Fresno State tackle Natane Moody, who projects probably better on the inside, and Oklahoma's Creed Humphrey. He's good at pass protection, but he is untested in the Big 12. He mainly just sees three-man fronts, and the scheme really protects him. Now let's talk about the exterior offensive tackle, and Andrew Thomas is the close thing to a sure thing when it comes to first round tackles. I do have Smith and Wirfs as fringe round first round tackles, but both, they have great potential, but they really need good production this year to solidify their draft stand-in. I have Walker Little as a second round prospect. He just needs to get a little more athletic. If we see that this season, he could make an argument for the first round. Now, if you've been following this channel, then you know I love Prince Tango Winagoho. And he's only been playing football for a short while, and he can make an argument for being the top tackle in the draft if he comes out and plays bonkers. Serious injuries to the back and ACL are too many red flags for Washington's Trey Adams for me to include him in the first round, and it's even pushing it as a day two pick. We have to see him healthy. I have at 7, Arlik Jackson from Iowa. He's shed some bad weight, about 10 to 15 this spring, and if he could be more athletic, then we could be talking about really a handful of first round tackles. Alex Leatherwood has played all positions on the offensive line at Alabama nonetheless, and I love the versatility. Liam Enchenberg has a very good skill set, but has been so-so. I think really he's just a right tackle only. At 10, I have Calvin Throckmorton from Oregon playing on the best offensive line in college football. He's made over 30 consecutive starts for Oregon and should be a capable starter in the NFL. Wisconsin's Cole Van Lannen was one of the best tackles last season. If he adds some weight, he will fly up this list, so much so that I included him in my underrated prospects video. And Lucas Nyan out of TCU has been very protected by the Horned Frogs scheme, but he does have a lot of the intangibles. Let's talk pass catchers, starting with tight end, and I currently have no tight end with a first round grade. But Albert Okwibenom and Jared Pickney are very close, and they're basically right now 1A and 1B in my eyes. Stanford's Colby Parkinson is a red zone threat and could receive some day two hype. I have Grant Calicatera of Oklahoma at number 4. He is a bit undersized, but he reminds me of Irv Smith Jr., who came out of Alabama this past season. Mitchell Wilcox has a bunch of untapped potential, and if he could realize that potential, we could be talking about him in day two. I added Arkansas's Cheyenne O'Grady, who he has some disciplinary concerns, but when he returned against Alabama last season, he was unguardable. 7 catches for 48 yards and a touchdown. Jake Breland and Hunter Bryant have been reliable targets for their respective teams, but Hunter was banged up a bit last season. But the real guy you need to keep an eye on is Florida Atlantic's Harrison Bryant, who is a very solid athlete. And to the receivers, and it's no secret that this receiving class is loaded. Probably the best receiving class since 2014. I have 6 receivers with first round grades, and that's starting with Jerry Jeudy, who is the best receiver prospect since Julio Jones or Calvin Johnson. Next, I have TCU's Jalen Reagor. If you've watched any of my mock draft videos, then you know I love Reagor. Laviska Shenault Jr. from Colorado is built like a running back, and he has more broken tackles than any other receiver last year. He had 31, to the next highest receiver was Jeudy with 17. He just needs to stay healthy. CeeDee Lamb is a very well-rounded receiver and a better prospect than Hollywood Brown, who went in the first round last season. Higgins has X receiver size and should be a very tempting pick come draft time. I love everything Minnesota's Tyler Johnson can do, but he is 5'11", so not as big as the other guys. I still love him, still think he's a first round pick. Colin Johnson out of Texas coming in at 7, another guy with prototypical size. Tylan Wallace needs to add some weight and add a few moves to his route tree, but he is dangerous there at Oklahoma State. Check out his highlights. Antonio Gandy Golden out of Liberty, sorry, couldn't fit the whole name. But he will probably garner more hype in the pre-draft process, being the Combine and Senior Bowl. At 10, I have Henry Ruggs out of Alabama, who he didn't perform too well in big games last season, especially down the stretch. But I think he is an ideal slot receiver, and we're in an NFL that highly values players that can play in the slot. And at running back, I have no one with a first round grade. I know, a bit controversial, and it only gets more controversial. But at number 1, I have Travis Etienne from Clemson. He's a bit undersized, but he is explosive, averaging 7 yards per carry, and he displays the ability to catch the pass, which in a passing league is highly valuable. The more I watch Swift, the higher I rank him. He's patient and has great vision and burst. Dobbins is a good north-south runner with the ability to catch the pass. Eno Benjamin out of Arizona State is another fast riser on my list. He's so good at making tacklers miss. Here's the controversial place in my rankings. I have Jonathan Taylor at 5, simply because he hasn't shown the ability to be a pass catcher or a pass blocker. I go into it more in my overrated prospects video, so check that out for more on this. It was a down year for Florida State, but Akers was the best player on the team last year. He's a little bouncy in the backfield, but he's a phenomenal pass blocker. Kylan Hill out of Mississippi State comes in at 7. He's very explosive at 215 with a mean stiff arm. Najee Harris is very agile for a big back, but he lacks speed and he can't catch the football. Keyshawn Vaughn was very good at forcing tacklers to miss. And speaking of making tacklers miss, more so tacklers not being able to bring down, at 10, I have Trey Sermon out of Oklahoma. He reminds me a little bit of Marshawn Lynch with his physicality. But he reminds me a little bit of also TJ Yeldon, because he does everything well, but he doesn't really do anything great. And to what everyone's been waiting for, the top cornerback prospects, and I got Tua at 1, but Tua and Herbert are basically 1A, 1B. We're going to hear a lot about these guys all year, so let's go on to number 3, Jake Fromm. He's a first round prospect, but he's not on the same level as Tua or Herbert. KJ Costello from Stanford is number 4. He's a prototypical type of quarterback. He's got good size, he has an NFL arm, and he could find himself in the first round discussion. Number 5, Nathan Stanley out of Iowa has a really high ceiling, but he has no playmakers on that offense, so will he be able to elevate his team? I think Jordan Love from Utah State has the best possibility to raise his stock. He led the Aggies to 11 wins last year, and that was with 32 touchdowns. And with a big season and a big game against LSU this year, he can find first round hype. I have Eason at 7, and he can very well end up being number 4 on this list at the end of the year, but we haven't seen him play in 2 years, so let's see him play a game before we give him some hype. Shea Patterson is playing under new offensive coordinator Josh Gattis, so the offense will be a little more up-tempo, and that should only help Patterson. Joe Burrow is a very intelligent player with some wheels. LSU is still going to be the type of team that pound the run game, but for the first time in almost like 15 years, they have a passing attack. I round this list out with Steve Montez out of Colorado. He has an elite weapon in Laviska Shenault Jr. and an NFL arm, so he should receive some day three interest. Other guys to watch out for is North Texas's Mason Fine and Houston's Derek Keene. Both have some size limitations, but boy, do they make some pretty throws. That's it for the video. Go ahead, do the YouTube stuff. Stay tuned. Defenses will be out a day from now, or depending on when you're watching it, it's already out. That being said, you be easy, my friends. Later.